This story in Matthew chapter 14, Jesus was preaching and healing and doing a lot of stuff. And then when the night came, he told his disciples, hey, you guys get in the boat and go on across the Sea of Galilee. I'm going to stick around here and pray for a little bit, then I'll catch up with you. Now, I know it's easy to look at the disciples like they're not that bright because, hey, their whole life is written in the Bible. And if my whole life was written in the Bible, I wouldn't look that bright either. But something just struck me. If Jesus says, go, and I'm going to stay, why are you going to go? Like, that's God. Don't leave God. Even if he sends you, you just stay there. If I'm going to pray with you. What are we doing? I'm going to hang out with you. But they weren't bright enough, so they went on. They got themselves caught in a storm, and that's where we pick up. Verse 27, it says this. But immediately, Jesus spoke to them, saying, be of good cheer. It is I. Do not be. Okay, so we skipped a part. Not a big part, but just a little part. The part where Jesus, like, walks on water to them in the middle of the Sea of Galilee where they were in a storm and everybody's screaming, Thaddeus and Matthew, ah, it's a ghost. And they're like, no, it's not a ghost. It's me. It's Jesus. Verse 28, and Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water. So he said, and Peter said, say what now? You see, I don't think Peter actually intended on coming out on the water. I think, oh, that's not God. Watch this, guys. Watch this one. Hey, if it's Jesus, then tell me to come. Come. No, that wasn't the plan. It says, come. And when Peter had come down out of the boat, he walked on the water to go. That's Jesus, Thriller style, moonwalking on the water. Verse 30, but when he saw that the wind was boisterous, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, saying, Lord, save me. And immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and caught him and said to him, oh, you of little faith, why do you doubt? And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. Stay standing. Let's pray. Father God, we're grateful. Grateful that you're the glorious King. Grateful that you're in this place right now. God, you're really here. You've come for one purpose, God, to meet with us, to speak to us, to transform our lives. I pray right now, God, that you would remove all stress, all worry, all anxiety off of every single person in the sound of my voice. Move supernaturally. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. And amen. Before you sit down, three people, high-five them and tell them you were made to walk on water. Not two, not four, three people. Count it out. Three people. All right, some of you cheating, that has to be four. Sit down, sit down, sit down, sit down, sit down. Stealing my preaching time. Have you ever been overwhelmed? You said that too fast. Fast, I'm overwhelmed right now. I'm not talking about stress. I think there's a difference between being stressed and being overwhelmed. You could have, like, you know, a long day, just nothing goes right for you. There's a lot going on at work. It was a stressful day. Maybe you string together a few of those days and it was a stressful week. But I believe being overwhelmed is not a day. It's not a week. It's just like a season where it seems like just one thing after another thing after another thing. And it's just like, I don't know if I can take any more of this. I am overwhelmed. You ever been there before? I actually know you've been there before because we took a survey on Easter Sunday and we asked, hey, what's the number one thing you would like to hear a message about that you think would help you where you are? You want to know what you said? Pastor, I'm stressed out. I'm overwhelmed. Some form of help. There's too much on my life. Really, really cool deal. One of the things we do here is at the beginning of the year, usually are doing our 21 days of prayer and fasting. The leadership will get together and we'll pray and we'll begin to map out what messages we're going to preach at least through the first 6 months of the year. So back in January, we decided that in May, we're going to preach a message about being overwhelmed and being stressed out. And then 4 weeks ago, you guys said, man, it'd be really nice if you preached a message about being overwhelmed and stressed out. Any A-Team fans? I just love it when a plan comes together. you know, no, I'm not talking about the 2013-18. I'm talking about the one back in the 80s. Like, I lost you. Anyway, I love it when a good plan comes together, when God literally is orchestrating in the church what's going on in your heart. So for the next 4 weeks, we're going to talk about how do I deal, how do I cope, what do I do when I feel overwhelmed? The feeling of being overwhelmed, sometimes it feels almost like you're drowning, like you're in over your head, like you're just sinking in issues and problems and there's just more. Maybe it's a loved one that's sick. Maybe you have young children, 2 or 3 children under the age of 3, and you're just like, man, if they say mommy or daddy one more time, they might go to live with their grandparents. You're just like, I don't know. Or maybe it's a financial issue. There's more bills than there are resources at the end of the month, and you just feel like you're drowning. You feel like you're overwhelmed. I've actually been drowning before, not drowning in situations, but actually drowning in water. And if you've ever been drowning in water before, you know it's stressful. Actually, I wasn't actually just drowning in water, but someone was actually trying to drown me, which is just a whole nother level. My wife and I... we're celebrating our 3rd anniversary this coming August. 3 years, come on now. We are going strong all the way good. By the way, did y'all hear I'm having a girl? Oh my gosh. I got the news and 5 gray hairs just boom, right out the beard. I went out and bought 2 guns. It's not good. I feel like Pharaoh. Every male child 2 years and under, we're not friends anymore. I don't like you. Stay away from my daughter. But anyway, when we first got married, we went on our honeymoon. We were married for three days. We went to an island, and we were on the beach. And I looked at my wife and said, hey, can you swim? And she's like, yeah, I can swim. And she looks at me. She's like, hey, can you swim? And I'm like, yeah, I can swim. I mean, when you say swim, what do you mean? You talking about with the floaties or without the floaties? She's like, no floaties. Like, yeah, I got you, I can swim. So we go out, you know, splashy in the water and, you know, getting ready. And then, you know, I'm just like, hey, you know, I've been married for 3 days. I got to let this woman know what type of man she married. Like, I got this. I can handle this. I said, babe, get on my back. I'm going to swim you out kind of deep. She's like, oh, are you sure? I'm like, yeah, I got this. So she hops on my broad shoulders and... you know she's not in here, right? And I start swimming out into the deep. Now, she thought I was swimming because I was moving my hands, but my feet were on the sand, and I was really just kind of walking her out there, but she didn't know, and that's the whole point. As long as she doesn't know, it's all good, because I got you, babe. So we're walking, and you know, the water is coming high, and she's like, ooh, it's getting high. I'm like, I got you. Don't worry. I'm good. So here we go, deeper and deeper out in the sea. Okay, we're like 10 feet away from the sand. But for me, it was deep. And I'm walking, and then all of a sudden, I feel nothing under my feet. Turns out that the sand under the water, it wasn't like even like sand's supposed to be. It was like even, and then it was like cliff. Then there was nothing. And I step off this, like, cleft under, and I just start going down. And as I start going down, I feel like this burden just weighing on me, pushing me deeper and deep. She was trying to kill me. So I did what every man who saves his wife in the deep, treacherous ocean would do. I flung her off so that, I mean, what did they tell you on the airplane? You know, put the mask on yourself and then the person, I'm like, look, babe, we can't both go out. Somebody got to tell this story. So I'm going to save myself. I'm going to catch you later. I'm all the way, I'm not ashamed to say this. By the way, I'm like sicing it. The water was like 8 feet high. All I had to do was hop up, but you know, I was stressing out. So I get literally, no joke, I get on the bottom of the ocean and I crawl my way back up the cliff. to like get to the point where I could stand up, and then I look around for my wife and she's like. Needless to say, we needed marriage counseling 3 days. You tried to kill me. No, you tried to kill me, actually. Question, though, have you ever felt like you were drowning? It's a different feeling. One of the reasons you guys are laughing at me, because if you can swim, you know the first thing that when you think you can't swim is what? Don't panic. Because when you panic, you start breathing in oxygen. I mean, breathing in water instead of oxygen. You lose energy, and then you die. At least that's how I see it in my mind. It's one thing to tell somebody not to panic. It's completely different when you feel like you're drowning. And somebody's around you telling you, hey, don't panic. Christians aren't stressed out. You know, if you had faith, you would just believe God in that situation. Oh, that's easy for you to say standing all the way out there outside my situation. But right here where it feels like I'm drowning, I don't know what I'm supposed to do as a Christian. I just know I am freaking out. Do you know David, King David, one of the greatest kings in Israel, he had a similar experience. The Bible says in Psalm chapter 69, verse 1, he said, save me, O God, for the waters have come up to my neck. You see, David couldn't swim. You can be great and not be able to swim. David couldn't swim. He said, I sink in deep mire where there is no standing. We must have had the same honeymoon. I have come into deep waters where the floods overflow me. I am weary with my crying. My throat is dry. My eyes fail while I wait for my God. You ever been in a situation where you're just like, God, where are you? I've been praying. I've been believing. I've been asking. I've been tithing. Like, God, where are you? Those who hate me without a cause are more than the hairs of my head. They are mighty who would destroy me, being my enemies wrongfully. Though I have stolen nothing, I still must restore it. Is it just me, or did David just switch the topic in the middle of the verse? One second he's talking about I can't swim and I'm drowning and somebody help me, like I need a floaty, and the next thing he's talking about his haters and getting accused of doing something at work that he didn't do. You see, David was never talking about swimming. The whole time he was saying, I'm overwhelmed and it feels like I'm drowning. God, I've been crying out to you, and I don't know if I can take more of this. Maybe you find yourself in that situation. If you don't, I have bad news and bad news. The bad news is you'll find yourself in that situation at some point. In that moment as a believer, what do I do? How do I get from the place where I feel like I'm drowning to where God wants me to be? I encourage you, come back over the next 3 weeks, especially next week. We're going to unpack that. We're going to talk about the feeling of being overwhelmed. Sometimes all stress isn't bad stress. Some stress is good stress designed by God to stretch you, to take you to another level. Now, some stress is bad stress. Some stress we feel overwhelmed because we took on more than God ever intended for us to take on. But one of the things we're going to learn over the next few weeks, that no matter the cause of the stress, whether it's from God or from us taking on too much, all stress demands change. The worst thing you could do when you're overwhelmed, when you're under stress, is say, hey, I just need to make it 3 more weeks or 2 more months, or I just need to make it to the end of this or to the end of that, or as soon as I graduate, or as soon as this happens, or as soon as that happens, I'll be okay over there. Now, there's something that God wants you to do right here. Over the next few minutes today, I just want to talk about, so what should my attitude be when I feel like I'm overwhelmed? How would God have me live direct as a believer in that moment of stress? You can pull out your sermon notes. The first blank I want you to write down is this, that you're walking on water. If you're going to understand why you're stressed out, why you're overwhelmed, why you feel like you're in over your head, you have to understand the reality that as a believer currently, right now, sitting in your chair, you are walking on. Look at somebody next to you and tell them, I'm walking on water. Look back at them and say, I have no clue what you're talking about. You know, preachers, they just have you say whatever. You're just like, I have no, what he said, okay, what he said. I believe this story of Peter stepping out of the boat, walking on water in Jesus, I don't believe there's a clearer picture of what it means to be a follower of God. Here it is, Peter sitting in the boat with the rest of the disciples, Thomas and Thaddeus and the two Judases and Matthew and all of them, and there's storms and it looks like they're going down. Here comes Jesus walking towards the boat, and Peter says, "If it's you, God, tell me to come out." And Jesus says, "Peter, come out." You have a decision to make in that moment. Am I going to stay in this boat hoping life works out? Am I going to just tough it out a little bit longer? Am I going to just stay with what's not quite working, but at least I know what it is? Or am I going to step out from my comfort zone and say, "Jesus, I trust you"? The life of a believer is a life of someone who's willing to step out of their comfort zone and say, "Jesus, I trust you." I've never seen anybody walk on water before. I don't even know if it's possible, but Jesus, it's better for me to take a risk on you than to stay where I am. Anybody in here, you feel like, you know, sometimes it's just better to take a risk on Jesus. I'm not quite sure how it's going to turn out. I'm not quite sure what it's going to look like, but I prefer to be on top of the water with Jesus than in the boat with that crew that looks like it's going down. Maybe you're in here and your entire family is Muslim and you're just like, "I don't know about this Jesus thing. I don't know about this Christian thing, but I'm stepping out of my culture. I'm stepping out of my background. I'm stepping out of how I was raised, and I'm going to take a risk on Jesus. I'm not going down with the boat." The thing you have to understand is, as a Christian, it means that you walk on water. It means that God has placed you in an arena that's just not normal. One of the reasons why we feel so overwhelmed and we feel so overcome by situations and circumstances is because we look around us and we said, "Man, when they went through that, they drowned. And when they went through that, they drowned. So it must mean that as I'm going through, I'm going to drown. The only difference is you're not them. You're not normal. You're a child of God. You were made for this. You were born for this. He called you out of the boat. You're going to be all right." Look at somebody next to you and say, "You're going to be all right." No. Not "you're going to be all right." No, all right. Tell them, you're going to be all right. The Bible says in John chapter 14, verse 12, it says, "Most assuredly I say to you, he who," somebody say, "That's me. He who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father." In other words, God is saying, as a follower of Christ, you were created to do the supernatural. You were created to do the impossible. You were created to walk on water. Stop seeing yourself as normal. You're not normal. You're super normal. You're supernatural, because the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, he's put his mark on your life. You see, people around you may be raising children, but as a follower of Christ, you're not normal, which means you're not raising children. You're releasing destiny. See, people around you are normal, so what they're doing is they're just working and trying to build a little bit of influence and a little bit of wealth so they can have a little bit of happiness and a little bit of comfort, but you're not normal. You're not just building your kingdom, you're building his kingdom, and he's called you to take dominion, to dominate in every single area that you... Look at somebody next to you, tell them, "I'm not normal." Look back at them and tell them, "I already knew." The Bible says in Psalm 82, verse 6, "I said, you are gods, and all of you are children of the Most High." Do you know that God called you a god? Now, I preached this in the first service, and they looked at me like I had four heads. What kind of blasphemy are you preaching? Got me up here saying I'm a god. Boy, you trying to get me hit by lightning. I'm not going there, Pastor. Do you know in John chapter 10, verse 34, Jesus actually quoted this exact scripture, and he said, no, you are gods. Don't trip. You're not God. You ain't big G God, but you're little G God. You were made in his image. You have the likeness of God. Your DNA doesn't come from your father or your mother. Your DNA comes from your Father. Like, it makes people all the way uncomfortable. I'm not a God. No. I'm just a lowly worm. I'm just a humble servant of the Lord. No, it's just little. Why are you saying things about you that God's not saying about you? You know, you went to school. You did the whole, you know, sheep give birth to sheep. Whales give birth to whales. Giraffes give birth to giraffes. Gods give birth to. Pastor, I don't know what you're talking about because I wasn't born from God. Well, you may not be a Christian because the Bible said you must be born. I'm having a lot of fun. We are way ahead of where you are. If you're born of God, you were made in the image of God. You have the authority of God, which means you were made to walk on water. And as long as you see yourself as some lowly little worm who's struggling through life and just trying to accomplish something, you'll always be overwhelmed because you won't realize, I was made for this moment. I was anointed for this moment. He placed me here on purpose. I can dominate not because of who I am, but because of who my daddy is. You gotta know you were made to walk on water. Second thing I want you to write down is this. But walking on water, it's just not normal. You know, we get all over church, oh, I'm a water walker. You go ahead, tell them, Pastor, I'm a walk all over my situation. And then you walk out of here, you realize, wait, hold on, that ain't normal, Pastor. Like, people don't walk on water. When people try to walk on water, they drown. And when they drown, they die. I don't know about that. Do you know what happened to Peter? Peter was walking on water just fine. The Bible never said that the storm got any worse than it was when he first stepped out. Do you know this earth is going to bug you out? It's about just as evil as it was when you started. I hate to tell you this, you really don't have any more haters than you did last year. You about right the same. The only difference is Peter started looking around. He saw everybody sitting in the boat waiting for him. Look at this joker, he is going down. And it struck Peter, this isn't normal. This doesn't really turn out well all the time. You see, when we get focused on how our life isn't shaping up like a whole bunch of other people's lives, how the path that God has us is just not necessarily the path of our older brother or younger sister or cousin or mom or aunt or the neighbor or the coworker, all of a sudden we get looking around instead of locked on Jesus, we start sinking in discouragement. Start thinking, man, you know, it didn't turn out well for them. It might not turn out well for me. The Bible says this in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. It says, for our present troubles are small. Have you ever disagreed with the Bible? I do all the time. God says, hey, what you're going through right now is no big deal. It's small. No, it's not. This is crazy. Cancer is not small. Bankruptcy is not small. This isn't small. He said, no, trust me, it's small. And it won't last very long. Don't you just hate, like, optimists? Oh, it's raining outside. Don't worry, it'll be sunny tomorrow. Man, this was a rough day. Oh, but it's going to be great tomorrow. Oh, life is tough. Oh, don't worry about it. It's just small and it won't last for long. No. He said, no, trust me. It's small and it won't last for long. Yet they produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever. So we don't look at the troubles we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on things that cannot be seen. For the things we see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. In other words, God was saying, hey, if you get locked on the thing that's going on in your life, it may seem like the biggest deal in the world, but listen to me, it's small and it's temporary. Let me just help you out with that. Think back 6 months ago, 12 months ago, maybe 24 months ago. Think about what the biggest problem in your life was. Oh gosh, I'm getting ready to graduate. Am I going to be able to get a job? How am I going to pay off these student loans? Oh, God, are you going to heal my body? Oh, God, are you going to open a job? Oh, God, are you going to do this? How big a deal is it right now? There may be stuff that's taken a long time and you're still waiting on it, but isn't it crazy how the thing that kept us up 12 months ago, we don't even remember today? Why? Because it was small. It was temporary, but it was designed to get you off your game. The whole goal of the enemy as a believer is to get you to focus on the small thing. To get you to focus on the temporary, to get you to focus on what's going on right now. Because if you focus on what's going on right now, you miss the big picture that, wait, God called me out here, which means he must have a plan and a purpose for me being out here. So yeah, it's a little wet and yeah, it's a little bumpy right now, but there's something that's coming. The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 59, verse 19, it says the enemy comes in like a flood. The Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against it. The whole goal of the enemy is to get you overwhelmed, to get you just rocked back on your feet so you begin to lose perspective of who God is and who he's made you to be. Anybody in here, you're scared of heights? I don't do heights. I don't do roller coaster. I don't do the Bay Bridge. Like, I just don't do heights. Can I tell you something that you may not know? You're not scared of heights. Kind of self-help mind manipulation. No, I'm scared of heights, bro. I'm scared. No, you're not scared of heights. Can I prove it? You know what you're really scared of? You're scared of being high up, falling, and dying. You're not scared of heights. What you're really scared of, you're scared of dying. Anybody here, you're scared of spiders? Spiders, spiders, hate spiders, can't do spiders. Boy, I will fight a lion, but I don't do spiders. Arachnophobia is what they call it. Do you know you're not actually scared of spiders? No, I am. I'd say if I see a spider, I will bug out. Oh my gosh, I can't deal with spiders. No, you're not scared of spiders. You know what you're scared of? You're getting scared of bitten by a spider and dying. Tracking with me? I'm scared of water. No, you're not scared of water. You're scared of drowning and dying. Any other phobias? I'm scared of the dark. No, you're not scared of the dark. You're scared of something jumping out of the dark and killing you. Are you getting where I'm going? You're scared of one thing. I don't want to die. What are you trying to say, Pastor? The enemy's goal is to get you to always think worst case scenario. And if I can get you to think worst case scenario, I could get you to feel overwhelmed and completely in over your head. Man, things are really stressful at work. I'm overwhelmed. No. What you're afraid of is that things become too much for you to handle, and they come and say, hey, you're not working out anymore. We're going to have to let you go. And then you can't find somewhere else to go, and then you have to lose your house, and then you're living under a bridge, and then you're homeless, and then you die. Tracking? So what we have to do, what the fight has to be is, I'm not going there. I'm not thinking worst case scenario. I know walking on water isn't normal. I know this Christian life isn't normal, so listen to me. I'm not expecting it to be easy. I'm ready for a fight. The most valuable information you can get as a Christian, listen to me carefully, anything worth having ain't easy. And as soon as you get out of your mind that being a Christian means that I'm just floating through life, and you get in your mind being a Christian means I was called to take back what the enemy has stolen, all of a sudden you're like, bring it on. I know it's not going to be easy. I know it's not going to be a fight, but I was born to fight. I'm ready to fight, and I know how to fight. Do you know how to fight? You know, it's really bad if you don't know how to fight. You ever seen somebody who don't know how to fight? I can't fight. That's why I don't get in fights, because it wouldn't be good. I talk a lot, but I always have somebody bigger than me around me because, you know, I'm just not a fighter type of deal. But I find a lot of Christians don't know how to fight. The Bible says this in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4. Boom. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds and casting down arguments. And every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Bringing, watch this, every worst case scenario into captivity to the obedience of Christ. So can I tell you how to fight as a believer? This is how you fight. When you go into work and it's just a stressful day and the enemy begins to sin, overwhelm you with the thoughts of, hey, you're going to get fired today. Oh, it's over for you. You can't cut it. You're not making it. This is not a good deal. Then you begin to tell yourself what Romans 8:28 says. No, he says all things work together for my good according to the scriptures for those who love God and called according to his purpose. So it doesn't matter what happens today because he's with me, and because he's with me, no one can be against me. Okay, you need to go home and put all your affairs in order. You have 3 months to live. There's nothing you can do. We caught it too late. Yeah. I know that's what you said. But the Bible says that by his stripes, I have already been healed. Oh, you see, this is just not going to work out. You know, we can't keep you, and you don't have enough money. You're going to lose the house, and it's just not going to go. No. The Bible says, never have I seen the righteous forsaken, nor their children begging for bread. If he's with me, what are you doing? You're taking captive the enemy's thoughts. The reason why you're overwhelmed is because there's thoughts that are running around in your mind that you haven't taken captive by the word of God. Here's the deal, though. You can only take the enemy's thoughts captives with God's thoughts. So if you don't know the word of God, if you don't know God's thoughts, you can't take those thoughts captive. You can't just throw some inspirational phrase at the enemy. I can do it. I can pull myself up by my bootstraps. What is that? I don't know what that is. You know, it's not enough for your pastor to know the Bible for you. Can I tell you something all the way real? I got just enough Bible to take my own thoughts captive. Sorry, but I ain't got none left over for you. And by the way, I'm not following you around all week long to give you a scripture to take care of every thought that the enemy throws your way. You have to know your word for yourself, so when the enemy comes at you, you can replace that thought and continue to walk on water the way that God made you to. The last thing is this, write this down. Jesus is on the water. You got to know that you were made to walk on water. And yes, walking on water isn't normal, but when you realize that Jesus is on that water with you, it changes everything. You know, it would make sense that Peter sunk if as soon as he got out of the boat, he went down. I mean, it'd be easy for us to say, okay, he didn't have enough faith. God never intended for him to walk on water. Walking on water isn't normal. That's not that you just stay in the boat, play it safe. No. He came out, and the Bible says he was actually doing it. He was walking on water. There's nowhere in the scripture where it says the storm got any worse. There's nowhere in the scripture where it says that Peter did anything differently except for one thing. He started to look around. He started to see the situation on around him. And just think about it. If Jesus is in front of me and there's waves that are all the way over here, unless I'm cross-eyed, I got to pick something to look at. TMI? Either I look at Jesus or I look at cancer. But I can't look at both at the same time. Either I look at Jesus or I look at the cutbacks. But I can't look at them both at the same time. A lot of times people say, you see, that's why I can't get with faith. You see, this thing they call faith, faith is just ignoring the reality, and that's crazy. I have no interest in it. No. Faith is not ignoring the reality. I'm sick, yeah. No, stuff are rough at work. Yeah, marriage, it's been better. The kids, still crazy. But Jesus is still on this water. And I choose to focus on the reality of Christ rather than the reality of my circumstance. The reason why Peter started going down is because he picked the wrong reality to focus on. It's crazy. People get in a whole lot of trouble, especially in different faiths and all this other kind of stuff. Where, you know, if I just say I'm not sick, I'm not sick. I don't care what the doctor said. I'm not sick. So he's going, hey, are you sick? No, I'm good. I'm good. I'm not sick. Not going to the doctor, not doing anything. No, I'm not sick. You know what that is? That's not faith. That's crazy. You sick. Look right there on the chart. You see it right there? Yep, that's sick. That's S-I-C-K. Yep, that's you. You're sick. Oh, no, I'm not getting laid off. My company, I'm going, oh, God's for me. He's not against me. It's going to be all right. Yeah, it may be. It may not be, though. I mean, I don't know if you follow finances and all that, but they just said Apple had the first loss in 13 years. If Apple goes down, the world is over. I mean, it's done. I'm digging my bunker now. It's over. You know your reality might be your reality. But when you focus on Jesus, when you lock your eyes, the Bible says, on the one who started you, and the one who's going to see you through to completion. Like they used to say, come hell or high waters, I'm focused on him. The Bible says in Philippians chapter 4, verse 6, I'm going to end here. Don't fret or worry. Instead of worrying, pray. You know why it doesn't quite work out for us? Because when we're overwhelmed or stressed or feel anxiety, our strategy for getting past it is to pretend like we're not worried. If I just don't act like I'm worried, then it's gone away. So this is what we do. We're stressed out and we're overwhelmed that we won't say anything. How was your day? Great. How are you doing? I'm fine. And then the people that are closest to us, our spouses and friends, they're like, ooh, what's wrong with you? I'm fine. Oh. Are you worried about something? No. Okay. You're not worried. All right. What are we doing? We're just bottling it up on the inside. You're worried. You can't sleep at night. You're just tossing and turning, thinking through scenarios. Jesus never said to bottle up your worry. He said, turn your worry into prayer. If you give me that verse again, it says, don't fret or instead of worry and pray. Watch this. Let petitions and praise shape your worries into prayers. Letting God know your concerns. Before you know it, a sense of God's wholeness, everything coming together for good will come and settle you down. It's wonderful what happens when Christ displaces worry at the center of your life. Can I tell you one of the best prayers you could ever pray? Jesus, I'm stressed out. You're God. You're sitting on your throne. You're the King of Kings. You're the Lord of Lords. But I'm stressed out. I'm worried. Take him through your worst case scenario. Jesus, I'm afraid that this is going to happen. If that happens, then this will happen. If that happens, then this will happen. And if that, Pastor, that's not prayer. You know, prayer is telling God how awesome he is and throwing scripture. Who said that? Prayer is talking to God about what's on your heart. And the Bible says that the Bible actually says to throw it on Jesus. You ever had a friend that just dumped all their issues on you? And you're just like, I don't know if I need to know all that. I don't want to deal with all that. No, Jesus said, bring it. Just dump everything you're worried about on me, and I'll take it. But not only will I take it, but I'll give you peace that will guard like soldiers, like sentries. They'll be guarding your heart and guarding your mind. Crazy thing. So here's Peter drowning. It says that Peter cries out and he says, God, save me. And what I think the scripture should have said is immediately Jesus calmed the storm. Or immediately Jesus empowered Peter to walk on water. Do you know Jesus didn't do any of that? When Peter cried out for help, it says immediately Jesus stretched out his hand. And he pulled Peter up back to where he was supposed to be. Could it be the reason why I'm so stressed out is because I'm praying for God to change my situation? And God is saying, don't worry about this situation. I'll change that. But before I change that, I want you back up here with me where you belong. You see, life got a little focus out of focus. It got a little stressful. It got a little worrisome. It got a little anxious. And in the moment, you lost your position in me. So we'll take care of the bills. We'll take care of the kids. We'll take care of work. But first, I just need you to be back up here with me where you belong. Everything else will take care of itself. Could it be that our prayer this morning is not, God, change this, fix this, or do that? But God, take us up to where you are. God, bring us up above our situation where we once were. Let's pray. Oh, Father God, we are grateful that because of your presence in our lives, you have made us not to be victims, but to be victors, to overcome, to walk over every storm that life sends. God, I pray in this moment that as we cast our cares on you, God, that your peace, God, would rush through this place. God, that we would know that you're right here with us. Just where you are with your eyes closed and your head bowed, can you do me a favor? Can you just pray this prayer? Say, Holy Spirit, what are you saying to me? Just give God a moment. Allow him to make this message personal to you. Maybe you have things that you've been bottling up that you just need to throw on God, worries and anxieties and fears that you just need to cast on him. Maybe you need to do what Peter did and scream out, Jesus, save me. If you're in here and you realize I've never thrown my life at God, I've never asked him for help, I've never given him control, or maybe you did and you took it back and you're kind of just figuring it out on your own, you realize I'm still in the boat. Today Jesus says to you, won't you come? Oh, no, I get it. It's a risk, but still come. I have a great plan. I have a great purpose for your life.